Right, so survival, inquiry, and sophistication is a kind of a joke from Douglas Adams' book. And really what I'm trying to say is that at the moment, in terms of computing, we are in a wonderful age where we are talking about where should we eat lunch. Yeah. And just to give you an idea of how far we've come, I left university about 17 years ago, and that was the year that a wonderful product called Windows 95 launched. I was lucky enough to develop on Windows 3.1.1 first. And just to give you an idea of how far we've come in the last 17 years. So you all remember Windows 95. Yeah? And right now, I'm not developing for Windows. Oops, I'm not developing for Windows 95. I'm developing for phones. So in terms of comparison between these types of platforms, so Windows 95, I bought a 486 DX4100 when I first started developing. Yeah. And that was top of the range. It was really good. There were just about Pentiums coming out, but they couldn't divide. and nowadays, instead of that, I get a phone. And really, this isn't even a high-spec phone now. Really, phones have quad-core, and they're all running at 1.5 gigahertz. The amount of processing you get in your pocket is huge. And then when you start looking at tablets and desktops, it goes up incrementally from there. In terms of RAM, optimal, not minimal, optimal for Windows 95. I guess some of you don't even know what Windows 95 is in the room. Sorry. But optimal is 8 megabytes of RAM. So, you know, and that probably cost about £100-150 extra on top of your 4 megabyte machine, which is the base unit. Yeah? Nowadays, the phone has a gigabyte RAM. Yeah? You know, typically, if your application only gets sort of 100 megabytes to play with, but you only get 100 megabytes to play with. That is huge. So in terms of the complexity of the applications you can put together, in terms of the capabilities that are there, it's really large. Obviously, Windows 95 came with it, and my machine did come with it, 13 floppy disks to install on. The update 2 for Windows 95 came with 26 floppy disks. CD-ROMs did exist, but floppy disks were still the standard issue. Phones, obviously, it's over-the-air upgrade all the way through. Max hard disk on a Windows 95 machine was 2 gigabytes. I think my machine, I paid extra and got 850 megabytes. Couldn't possibly think what I could fill that with at the time either. It was huge. Obviously now, 32 gigabytes flash disk, kind of standard. Then you get SkyDrive just to replicate all this stuff. So in terms of capabilities, again, we've come a huge way in sophistication. I, again, upgraded just because I wanted to use CompuServe. People in the room don't know what CompuServe is, you're so missing out. Facebook is nothing compared to CompuServe. You had little short nicknames for people, you could send messages backwards and forwards, you had keywords, it was wonderful. However, your phone, I mean, typically now for phones, if you're talking about modern applications, particularly for enterprise, you're talking about bandwidths of sort of 20 megabits per second you can look at. And obviously there are other near-field communications, Bluetooth communications you can look at. So connectivity is you know, again, we have reached sophistication. Price as well, I paid £1,200 for my machine. Phone, £400 is actually high. If you look in the newspaper today, you can pick yourself up sort of a the Amazon tablet, the HD. I think it's about £140 for a 7-inch tablet. It's stunning value. Sorry, Andy, I was at your talk yesterday. If you're looking at doing embedded devices, just buy a tablet and you'll have all this sort of capability and more to play with. So with that kind of background about the level of technology that's available for you, on with some engineering and some talking about code today. So you will hear about C# during this talk a lot. And I will be talking about C# from the cloud to the clients, how they talk to each other. And we'll try and show some code. But I'm aware that when I finish, lunch starts, and therefore we all want me to finish. I'll show you some real app examples. And then Q&A, probably better if we just go through and do that during lunch. Not least because there are giveaways and I get to keep them if nobody asks any questions. Right, so why C#? The answer that most people seem to come up with is this bottom one, and it is a good answer. It is, you know, valuable. Oh, I see, people at the back can't see the bottom one. I should put more at the bottom of the screen. It is a good answer that you get to reuse all the skills you've built up over the last 10 years of .NET. You know, it is valuable, you can reuse that, you've got all your tools. Everybody uses things like ReSharper. It is wonderful how productive you can be in Visual Studio 2010 and Visual Studio 2012 with these extras from, you know, ReSharper and beyond. NuGet is there for you to use. You will also, no doubt, have existing code libraries that you can deploy. However, that's not really the reason to move forward with it. Yeah, the real reason to move forward with it is the stuff at the top. It's because actually you can build fantastic applications with it. Yeah, if you find yourself sticking with a technology because you know it, you're doing the wrong thing. If you find yourself sticking with a technology because it still produces excellent, you know, things that people want out there, your customers want, your customers will pay for, then that's the reason to go for it. And in particular, we're going to talk a lot today, or we're going to hear, you're going to hear, I'm going to talk about the native side of things. I don't myself as a user quite understand how important native is, but it is important. Yeah. Everything we see is so important about the feedback people get. You know, Windows 8, you see how much effort has gone into the App Store, into the marketplace. Right? App Store is a trademark of Apple. I must put that in small print underneath, into the Windows Store, and how important it is that things are delightful. You heard that a lot if you ever went to Windows Phone 7 talks. Make your applications delightful. Even your line of business, make sure that they are pleasant on the eye and pleasant to use. So, yeah, I get this a lot. I get, what about JavaScript? Yeah? JavaScript is amazing. It's actually what I'm doing for the last couple of months, building JavaScript applications. And there are superb libraries out there to write JavaScript with. I think you saw some of them yesterday morning when I wasn't here. I think, you know, things like high charts to do charting with. I've used JQ widgets recently just to put, you know, jQuery UIs on top of. I've also, actually I might have it up. There's a library called d3.js that, I won't show you my mail. D3.js is something that Scott Hanselman showed at Build. And this application that I did for my partner, who's a teacher, just put together, I think it took me a day end-to-end. It uses CoffeeScript. It would use TypeScript nowadays. It is a basic sort of, anyone used Pivot Viewer in Silverlight? Yeah, so it's a basic Pivot Viewer. You can, you know, group people by their class. So these are students, don't worry, everything's anonymized. You get the hover over effect. You can ping your worst children across the room. you can color them according to their achievement. You can remove the boys so you only look at girls. You know, all of that type of filtering. To do that in a native application and to do it cross-platform would take you weeks, if not months. So Java...
That's amazing.
JavaScript, and so the guy who wrote D3.js, I would follow him if I was you. If you're on GitHub, follow him. He's called Mike Bostock. He produces probably two or three samples every day. Go and take a look at Scott Hanselman's talk from Build. The amount that you can put together in D3.js, it's all scalable vector graphics. It runs on iPads. Yeah, it runs on Surfaces. You can run it inside your Windows Store applications if you're using WinJS. It's just, you know, in terms of what you can deliver, it's much more than you can deliver in a native application. So, back to the talk. I am talking today about C#, but I do acknowledge that JavaScript has huge potential, huge advantages. Yeah, so please, if you've got an application in-house and you are, you know, worried about the fact that you need to update it every week, consider going the JavaScript route and the web app route, because if you are deploying through through stores like Apple, you're deploying through stores like Microsoft, you will have a minimum turnaround of a week. They can turn you down for random reasons. They can turn your application off for random reasons. So there are huge advantages with just being a website. Yeah. However, as this bloke, whoever he is, says, and if he wants to buy anything, I've got some things going at a billion. he you know, very publicly has said, we made a huge mistake in just doing HTML5 apps. Yeah. And I think if you follow through the kind of link here, just through his TechCrunch interview, he also pointed out that as soon as they switched away from using HTML apps to using native apps, the level of engagement of users went up by a factor of two. Yeah. And these aren't, you know, rubbish developers by any means inside Facebook. These guys knew what they were doing, they were using cutting edge, they were testing, but still they couldn't get that level of engagement and interactivity that their users really wanted. So if you are, you know, going to take over the world, consider going native. If you're going to consider going native and you want to go cross-platform, there might be a language you can use. So that's the client side of it. Server side of it, why Azure? Well, I wouldn't have been invited today if I didn't have the right answer to this. I think for me, the main reason is convenience. Yeah, it's just there. You can upload to it. If you're using the more modern platform as a service stuff, so I'm particularly thinking of the websites, the mobile services, then deployment is really quick, your development cycle is really quick, There are loads of samples available. It's straightforward to use. And then behind that, you've got flexibility of, you know, really being able to scale in storage, really being able to scale in compute. You've got connectivity at a really good level to things like Windows services. So if you need to do push messages, then you really want to be inside Azure to do it. Because the only way to send a push message inside to the Windows Store so that your app, you know, can show a toast or update its badge, its live tile, sorry. The only way of doing that is to send one message at a time to the Windows Store. So if you have a million users, you have to send a million messages. Yeah. If you're inside Azure to do that, that will take you a minute. If you're outside Azure to do that, it will probably take you 3 or 4 hours and may fail rather than it. So there are really good reasons why you should be inside Azure. Other reasons, if you're in more of a B2B role, is the privacy and security story, I found, is the other way around to what people talk about in the cloud. When they're talking about the cloud, people are saying, well, you know, where's my data? I'm worried about it. Actually, when I talk to my customers, they go, you're not looking after my data, are you? I go, no, Microsoft are. And they feel much more relieved about that statement. And yeah, quick updatability. I was lucky enough to be involved in Azure when it was called Red Dog. Showing my age, anyone involved in Red Dog? Oh, at least a couple about there. yeah, the improvements in terms of actually being able to deploy, particularly I think in the last year. So again, Redshirt, Scott has Big Red, I think we called him, has done a great job in terms of making that team really focus on usability and on developer convenience. Yeah, added to that at the bottom, you do get an awful lot of toys coming through, and that toy list has actually grown more and more recently. And so one of the things we're working with at the moment is with Hadoop on Azure, and you know, the capabilities are coming through and are growing all the time. And you know, we just heard about Active Directory as well, so yeah, it's growing. Sorry, it's not really Active Directory, pseudo Active Directory. Important to realize, Azure is big and it is pretty cheap. You know, if you need to deploy to millions of users, you can. However, it's not free and it's not infinite. I think you guys, I missed the morning session yesterday, heard about people who hit the limits of 100 terabytes in one account. There are also limits in terms of practical limits about how many transactions you can do against storage. Those have gone up by a factor of 4 recently, and the pricing has dropped by a factor of 10 in the summer, which is really convenient and very nice for us. But still, you have to think about how you structure your data. And if you are going to be a runaway success, which is a lovely thing to be, I've never done it, it's a lovely thing to be, then you need to think about some of the scaling issues up front. The last thing you want to do is be a runaway success and then discover you can't scale. Yeah. So, an example. This isn't one of my apps. These are some guys that I bumped into who work here in London. Faster Solutions have a lottery app. And they deploy to Azure in a very, very simple way. But I think it's a very cunning way to do it. So they have they have lottery results from, I think it was something like 120 different countries around the world. Most of those lottery results are gathered by screen scraping, by getting the HTML and trying to find the information inside it. I think they said pretty much 2 a week of the 120 break. Yeah. Because, you know, they're screen scraping and the HTML changes. You know, perhaps they didn't get their regular expressions right in the first place. So that side of it, if they put it onto the mobile app, then they would have to update mobile apps every single week in order to get the 2 going through. So they put all of that kind of screen scraping functionality in the worker role, and then they talk to storage. In this case, they mainly used Blob and a little bit of SQL. And the web role just serves those to the client, but also the worker role, if you have from the client stored your lucky numbers, can actually check those things and can send push notifications. So it was a remarkably simple architecture. It did cost them pretty much running one worker role full time, and then 2 extra small web roles just to give a bit of redundancy. They said it was incredibly easy to look after because it just really looked after itself. And I believe they were working on making the worker role itself actually kind of take the scripts, the regular expressions, etc., dynamically, so they were never updating the system. Yeah, it was just sitting there taking some stuff off blobs for the scripts to do the screen scraping, and it was just sitting there mediating this information. So that was just one example application of the sort of thing you can put together if you've got these clients out there and the server. So let's talk about some code. The demo I'm just going to show through is called TweetPic. There is a Windows Phone on that far side, it's Windows Phone 7, but I will go way beyond the Windows Phone. And you can see what we're going to put on the right hand, well, left hand side, the design here, right hand side as you're looking at it, is we're going to look at how we put things in Azure Storage, in SQL Azure, and how we use the Azure website. I think everybody in the room has used Azure quite a lot. Am I correct? You're all, no? Okay, I'll do a little bit of a balance, but I will go quite fast. I suspect you're a very good engineer anyway, and you'll be fine. So let's switch across to some code. So for TweetPic, so you all know what TweetPic is. This is TweetPic. Really what we want is we want an index of users for which we will authenticate against Twitter. And we would like to have, for each user, the ability to upload photos. Yeah. So just looking at that solution, all I've done is I've run a very simple ASP.NET MVC application. And in the back end of that application, don't worry, it will get bigger, this font, I have put a code-first entity framework system. So I have defined, we will have some users. Yeah, each user, we're going to have some Twitter information. Do scream if you can't see anything. Sorry, I don't know how clear it is at the back. We'll have some Twitter information. We'll have the stored tokens that we use to talk to them. A little bit of information about where they connected from. And that's it. And then we will have a table of pictures. Yeah. For this, I've used Entity Framework. For this level of information, you could use Azure Table Storage. When it comes to indexing, I tend to shy away from using Azure Table Storage just because it's very hard to answer questions like, how many users do I have when you're using Azure Table Storage? Yeah. The only way of counting things in Azure Table Storage really still is to pull every single information back. It's also very hard to back it up. Yeah, like you have to pull everything back, essentially. So picture is very straightforward as well. It's just got a picture ID, a unique name, and when uploaded, and then it's got a link to the user. So this is my SQL. Yeah, I don't write any SQL in this at all. This is just code first. I can connect to the database. I can upload. I'm not going to do that demo live because I think I've probably only really got an hour today, so I won't do that live. But literally all you do is you wrap it in a TweetPic context. So this is your database context. This, you know, will automatically be maintained for me. If you do need to migrate versions, then you can do that again using Entity Framework migrations. Or you can break the code first in this and actually do it yourself if you want to as well. And just for demo data, I've also put some demo data in here of various things which I've uploaded allegedly. Yeah, so that's my SQL. Yeah, I didn't need to write any SQL. I wrote C#. As I said, we'll be seeing C# code today. Yeah. So in order to connect to that context in my application, I don't think I need these breakpoints today. All I do is I have a connection string, which is to a SQL Azure instance. And then all I literally do is I've set an initializer so that seed data can go in, but I literally just say my connection factory uses my connection string. And that means anywhere in my code, I can talk to the database. Obviously, in a full app, I'd use a nice repository pattern and I'd have testability in there. But for this, that's it. So NoSQL, that's what my NoSQL looks like. It's C#. To actually use the service, I've got a couple of controllers. The first of these is so again, does everyone know what ASP.MVC looks like? Is everyone familiar and happy? Good. There's no reason you can't use web forms. And in fact, there are quite a few good applications going up now in terms of web forms on ASP.NET websites, on Azure websites. But literally all of this guy does is it's got a IOC dependency injection controller so it can be tested. And then it talks to some services in order to do Twitter authentication. I guess we've had quite a long talk about authentication today already. The reason that I do authentication myself in this at the moment is because there is a very good service on Azure called ACS, but it doesn't work with Twitter. It works with Facebook wonderfully. It works with Live wonderfully. It works with anything that's OAuth 2. Twitter is still something called OAuth 1.0c, and as a result, it won't talk to it. And personally, I think if I was Microsoft, I'd have found a way to get them talking to each other, but they've been playing Mexican standoff, whatever, and saying, Twitter will change. It's their call. So you can see that's a very simple controller. And then the picture controller is the guy that you talk to in order to get hold of a list of pictures. And all the picture controller does is it talks to the picture service to upload pictures, or it talks to the picture service to get the latest pictures. Picture service is down here, and the picture service. Okay, so I'll start with the get, because the get's the easy part. So the get latest, all it does is it creates a new database connection, and then it uses link, which is one of my favorite things in the whole wide world, to actually pull back the pictures, and then it just returns. Yeah, so there's a little bit of select, a little bit of casting to do that. There are lovely tools around there to do, like AutoMapper, if you want to generate those things. Try to keep that break if you can in your data so you're not passing back database objects to the client. And then when that goes back to the picture controller, then you will get, you know, the latest. What I'm doing here is I'm returning JSON. I'll talk about another way of doing this in a moment. But this was the way I demoed it and prototyped it, and the way I've written probably about 3 or 4 applications live out there pre-June this year. Yeah, pre the release of the web API, which is a better way of doing this now. So you can see how that works. If I just publish this up to the web, so shall I just prove that there is a change? So we're going to change that to 50. This might be the end of the demo. I might have to go back to slides after changing things. And then I build it. Then if you want to publish to Azure, then the first thing you need is a network. Please, demo gods. So you know, I've made a change from 100 to 50. And then if I actually publish this guy, then what you will see is how wonderfully fast Azure development can be. You can preview the changes if you want to, or you can just hit publish. And what it should be doing here is it will do a quick build, and it has published. And that is the speed that you actually work at when you're working with Azure websites. If you are working with the older level pass, if you're working with web roles, that particular sequence will take about 15 minutes, because what they will do is they will tear down your old instances. They will then allocate new machine images. They will then allocate machines to those machine images. They will then reboot those machine images. They will then wait for those things to start up IIS. So, you know, it's a much slower development cycle. But if all you need is, you know, straightforward web services or straightforward websites, please switch to Azure websites. Not only that, another advantage is that if you are low usage, they are free. What more can you want in life? I think I just changed, what did I change? Picture / latest all. No. Hang on. So if I hit picture latest all, hopefully it comes back. Okay, you can't see, unfortunately. It has come back with 50 things rather than 100, and that change has been made. Yeah, and you can see this is JSON. It's not the best, cleanest demo of JSON, but it is. If you need to work with JSON, there are some lovely services on the web, like JSON Viewer, chrisphotobooks.com JSON, and you just paste your JSON in, and then you hit render, and hopefully you have, you know, nicely formatted. And if we pull back any of these, were there 50? You see 50? Well, I didn't show you if there were 100 before, but you'll have to take my trust on that one. If you pull that back and you actually want to go to one of these guys, let me pull it back a large. So this is my demo data. I love my demo data in this particular application. I've just remembered what it is. So my demo data is 100 houses that look like faces, which is just wonderful. So yeah. Yes, they are this. Actually, I'll just sit here for an hour playing with these. if anybody wants this data set, I've got it. So that's how quick and easy it is to write your server side. So hopefully you saw on the right hand, well, you know, most of the middle of this. I haven't shown you the blob storage, which I'll show you in a second. But you saw how easy it was to put the index together. It's using C#. Website, C#. You know, I have installed, obviously, NuGet. I've got ReSharper installed. I use it a heck of a lot. You know, it's home to me. I'm so much faster. I also use, you know, and we'll come on to the Mono tools, the Mono develop, etc. But, you know, there is a reason that Visual Studio costs £7,000 in its ultimate form. It is a very good tool, and there's a reason that ReSharper costs £100. In fact, there isn't. It should be £7,000 as well. It's a wonderful tool to use. So Azure Storage, let's just talk about upload and how the data is done. So back in the picture service, when an upload occurs, should use ReSharper to navigate this, really. Then what actually is sent from the client at the moment is, it's a very straightforward post message. And you send your device token, which identifies who you are. It's a lightweight form of identification. And you send your picture in base 64. And what you'll notice is the first thing that happens is something called upload pictures. Yeah, which is brief upload picture. And then what happens is it gets added into the index. Yeah. So upload picture, hopefully down the bottom here, you'll see. What it does is it converts from the base 64 string into bytes. We then load a web image from the byte. So a web image is, you know, typically a JPEG. And then you might just see off the edge, I think I have actually done it, an Azure Blob storage account. So Azure Blobs, S3 for you, those guys who live in the Amazon world. It is a very scalable storage area. It's very flat storage area. If you have set your options so that it's public, then people can just go to those URLs and download the images without going through your web service, which if you're doing an image hosting service is great, because you don't really want to be hosting the compute power that talks to this guy that then puts it back to the client. So you want them to go straight there. If you have more advanced requirements, there are also things like shared keys, which shared signatures, which means you can give people temporary access, including you can give them temporary upload access. And I guess we might come into that this afternoon when we hear about the mobile services, the new toys. So what I do is I've connected to a storage account. At this stage in this line, all it's doing is parsing it, so it's just creating a C# object. Still here, I think all it's doing when it does get container reference is creating another C# object. I then resize my image into the right type and upload it to large. So this line here, the upload byte array, is actually doing a hit to Azure, to the storage area. But because it's all inside the Azure data center, it's an incredibly fast upload. Yeah. You could, and you probably should as you rewrite this code in the modern age, use async for this. Because what you can do at the same time is you can resize to the thumbnail size and perhaps other mediums, and you can re-upload all four of them at the same time, and you can probably free up your IIS thread at the same time to do that. Yeah, so that's upload in its entirety. Yeah, so that's my entire for TweetPic blob storage connection, and I think now you've also pretty much seen my entire SQL connection. Yeah. I don't know how much TweetPic's worth out there, TweetPic. They seem to have done okay off of it, but it's mainly an advertising revenue. But if any of your applications need to upload photos to a store, this is a great way of doing it. Whatever happens, please don't put them inside SQL. Yeah, it's a bad thing to do to put your image files inside SQL. There's just no data in there that really needs to be referenced. Okay, so I think that does show the entire of the kind of service. One thing I haven't really talked about is if you were very quick to look, when you actually looked at something like picture controller, you would have seen at the top was a word compress filter. And the reason for that, I'll show you some numbers in a moment, is if you are talking to mobile devices, even though I said we were an age of sophistication, and even though I was talking about 20 megabits per second connections, I guess if any of you check the email in the room at the moment, you probably won't get your 20 megabits per second. So always compress your data if you're talking to clients. They have plenty of CPU available to decode this data. And if you're talking in JSON or you are talking in XML, even worse, compressing your data is a very good thing to do. Yeah. If you're using the web API, then that compressed filter technique doesn't actually work when it goes up to Azure websites. So you have to use a different compress type, but it's still very straightforward to do. And there are plenty of blogs about how to do it. Your web pages, if you go up to Azure websites, those MIME types are encoded as gzip by default, so that's good. But anything you return as application JSON or application XML doesn't get encoded by default. Everyone knows about Fiddler? Telerik Fiddler. Use that tool. Use the tools inside Chrome or inside Firebug in Firefox or inside F12 in Internet Explorer if you really must, to find out the information about these guys. So, they are rewriting the tools for Internet Explorer. So, they admit that they're 10 years old, and they haven't been touched. So, hopefully, if you take a look at console for this guy, it's going to give me any information. Hopefully, you can see that data structure that's come back with all 50 items in there, which was this data structure here. Oops, not that one. I don't know what that is. This guy, over the wire, is actually being transferred as 750 bytes. Yeah, which even my free Tesco connection can cope with. Plug there for Tesco. Hopefully they'll give me another phone. Right, so back to the demo, back to talk. So that's the right-hand side. That's all of your stuff. Hopefully you all feel comfortable that we've stayed in C# so far. Haven't moved far outside of it. We did see a little bit of JSON. Then we want to talk about the client side, so we'll talk about that next. So storage, SQL versus Entity Framework. I think you saw that. Azure blob uploads, very little code to do a blob upload. Really straightforward to do. You can, if you prefer, use WCF. And so I did very quickly put an OData guy on this one. So if you take a look here, there is an OData service. And the OData, this is the entire code for OData. Has everyone used OData? Everyone know what OData is? OData is basically an RSS format, and they've written some nice wrappers for it. And so, you know, all this guy does literally is it talks to the context. Where's the context set? There, exactly the same DB context you've seen. Sets some rights, so particularly it's saying nobody's allowed to look at the private data that's the user's, but everyone can look at the picture data. And then there's just a little hack there to make sure I can actually use it on Azure websites. So if I go to that URL on the live service, what is it called? TweetPicOData. Yes. So if you go to TweetPicOData, having uploaded that to Azure, then you get back this guy. Yeah, it's just XML. If you then want to start drilling down inside, then you can do that. And it's a really straightforward, okay, not if you type it wrong, you can't caps lock on. It's a really straightforward mechanism to get the data back. And you'll see what it's come back with is 50. Okay, you have to view the source in here to actually see. It's doing long lines for me today. So that's the data, the same sort of thing in OData format. The one of the advantages of OData is it does, you know, that much code that you saw in here, you know, really gives you something quite flexible if you do want to query it. So you can write queries against these things. For example, if you just want the fourth picture, you can pull back just the fourth. Oh, no, you can't. How do you pull back the fourth picture? Anyone know? Ah, it's got an L on it because it's a long number. Because obviously my TweetPic service will not just have ints, it will have long. Yeah, so you can pull back that information. Open with Notepad, please. And that's just the fourth bit of information. Yeah. So it's a really straightforward way to get hold of that sort of thing. And it just gives you that. If you also have relationships between objects, so if I had enabled users, do I dare? Let me just show you that. So if you do enable users, then you should be able to browse from a user to the pictures. So again, if I build this and publish, I have only ever once used this OData in a real application. It's not my preferred way of doing data because whilst it is very quick to get running, catastrophic failure. What on earth? Oh, have I lost the network? No. Do I dare run that again? Is there anyone from Microsoft who knows about catastrophic failures? Has anyone seen the pictures of the Brazilian model last week who was in the hurricane in New York? Yeah, and it started this internet meme about catastrophic failures that she posed at. No, you haven't seen these pictures? No. So she's posed there. There were pictures of her like at Bambi's death. Or Bambi's mum's death, where she was posing. My favourite one was she was apparently at the Vista launch alongside Stephen Bell. So. Right, so if we've uploaded that and then we go to that same OData service, then hopefully we will now see. So now, you know, just to prove that that has genuinely gone up to Azure websites in that time, that's your development cycle now, yeah? And if you want to publish to, you know, a staging server, just launch one. They're free. Microsoft's paying the bill. Is there anyone from Microsoft in there? So now if you go to a user, you can do a users. Let's just pull back the first one because that will be me. Oh, no, it won't. Users, I only expected a 32-bit number of users. So hopefully if we take a look at the users, if anyone can get Chrome working on my Windows 8 box, please do. There is a reward if anyone can get Chrome working on my Windows 8 box. So now you'll see, hopefully, that in here you have a list of pictures attached to user 1 somewhere. So I think all I have to do, if I do users 1/pictures, if I have set up my data properly. So you can see how, sorry, it's probably too small on the screen, but it's, the URL is tweetpico data service, users, brackets one, pictures. Then when I pull that back, hopefully it will return the list of pictures that user one has uploaded. Yeah, so in terms of writing a data service that you can navigate and push through, it's incredibly quick as a wizard goes. And there are rules that you can put on top for security and authentication as well. However, I still don't quite trust it. So I'm not. So I don't really use it much. The only customer I've ever used it for is Microsoft. sorry. So that, I think, is the entire server side. So I can go back to the slides. As I mentioned briefly, oops, going the wrong way. This is the way that I've written most of my apps to date, using JSON inside normal ASP.NET MVC controllers. However, from the summer onwards, I've switched to the API controller. Has everyone used web API? Has anyone used web API? Yeah, you know, literally all you do if you want an API controller is you right click, assuming I've got the right version of it, and you do add new controller, and as your default option, catastrophic failure. you choose an empty API controller, and that will give you JSON services straightforward. There are some minor differences in the way they're put together. Yeah, so you know, things like the compress filter can surprise you. Always test things are working on the real life website, not just in debug. So I've switched mainly to using those. There are other options as well. Azure Mobile Services, there is an excellent talk coming up this afternoon from Richard. In-depth talk about Azure Mobile Services. They are the new toy for Microsoft. They use something called JavaScript. They're a very useful tool. I haven't used them in anger yet, but I have used them in demo last night. And in terms of getting up and running quickly, they give you a lot of capabilities there. There are other people who do similar services and have been around a bit longer. There's a company which actually spun out from Microsoft, or they left, it's probably a better way of putting it, called Buddy, who do a lot of JSON services. So if you need things like location data, if you want to start at Foursquare, they've got directories of locations you can use. But they also provide this kind of generic data storage. And then there are options like StackMob, who do the same sort of thing. Obviously, if you're inside Microsoft and you're inside Azure, then Azure Mobile Services are a good way of going. Finally, you can also, you know, across all the C# platforms, use WCF, and it's always fully supported. Except it's not quite always fully supported. Anybody who's used WCF knows you configure it, and anybody who's used WCF knows you swear at it, and eventually it works. So it's not my preferred way of working. If you're inside an enterprise, there are very good reasons for using it. But you know, and if it's an existing WCF service, there are good reasons. Otherwise, the world has changed to a REST service, really. As I said very briefly, their size matters. So if you take a look at the picture data that you've just seen, I think this is actually for 100 items. So if you were returning raw XML, yeah, it's 58 kilobytes for 100 pictures. If you are returning JSON, it's 21 kilobytes. And if you gzip that JSON, you'll get down to 2 kilobytes. Yeah. So think about your users and compressor. You know, it's trivial to do, but we all forget to do it sometimes. The worst particular candidate for this, I don't know about Windows Phone 8, but if you're going to Windows Phone 7 clients, you have to hack the web client stack in order to request compressed data, because by default, Windows Phone 7 doesn't actually supply the accept encoding GZ on it. So you have to actually add that in manually. But again, it's worth testing. I think an awful lot of Twitter clients for Windows Phone 7 didn't set that flag. As a result, they look abysmal compared to the iOS and Android. Because you know they're waiting for 2 kilobytes of data. Windows Phone 7 users are waiting for 20 kilobytes of data. Guess who shows the tweets on the screen first? So, recap. Code first, C#. Logic was all in C#. It's pretty trivial logic, as you've seen for this guy. But you know, you can build up your dependency injections and IOC. You can really build sophisticated things. And then for presentation, it's MVC JSON or WCFO data. You are not limited to these technologies in any way, shape, or form. There are an awful lot of other things you can use. Quite a few of those on the right-hand side I have used. Service Stack is lovely as a library. Protocol Buff Net, if you're looking for compressed data over the wire again, protocol buffers are Google's mechanism for communication and storage for a reason. They are very good. Mark Gravel from Stack Exchange is one of the authors of the main library that's used. John Skeet is the author of the other one, so you can trust this code quite a lot. Quite a lot. That never goes by. I've used that again with clients. It's very good. It's cross-platform, obviously, being protocol buffers. It's a binary format, so it's harder to debug. But it is versionable. So if you need to increment your communications mechanism, then protocol buffers gives you a good way of doing that. All of those other things are also available, and things like RavenDB give you another mechanism for storage on the server. The client. So let's just start with a really trivial client, just a Windows Phone 7 application. Let's pull them together. Simple demo. And all this is a bit of code behind and a bit of XAML. So what we are doing is we will have a button on the screen. When that button gets clicked, we will hide something. We'll create a new web client. Web client is the simplest but also the most stupid way of doing data transfer because it uses the UI thread. Maybe a good thing now in the async world. We hook into download string completed, and then we call into our web service. Yeah, so when that comes back into process results, all we are doing here is using Newtonsoft JSON converter, which is pretty much the standard way most things are now doing JSON. So Microsoft ASP MVC is now standard on JSON. It's not the fastest, it's not the smallest. Service stacks seem to have that kind of thing at the moment, but this is a standard. It's very easy to use, and it is certainly fast enough and small enough. I think probably the fattest and the slowest is the old data contract JavaScript serializer. It still has its place in life, but Microsoft have moved on. So all we do is we deserialize, and then we set the source to the thing. So if I do show that running, let me see if this guy is. No, that's a different. So if you go to a Windows Phone emulator and you run this guy up, get rid of that distracting one. It's got a great splash screen. In fact, it's got a great user experience all over. Then hopefully it will load. When it loads, you can hit get latest photos. And then it's gone off, and I suspect the speed this is working, that it probably isn't using gzip data. And you can see it's pulled back those latest photos. Yeah, so if I'd uploaded a new one, it would be there, and you can see these lovely houses with faces. So that's a very simple client.
It's a really unhappy house.
I'm sorry. I'll see if I can find it. Hang on, I'm going to stop. So that's a very simple client. You can see how little code is involved, and hopefully you saw that it was C#. Yeah, it was none of this funny jQuery. --/. So it's test. Well, this particular example isn't very testable, as you can see. Yeah, it's all code behind. It's all really closely tied to this horrible thing called XAML. You really want to move beyond that. So if you are creating an application and it's your first Windows Phone 7 application, this is the way to go. Yeah. If you are creating an application and it is your enterprise's application, then I would expect you not to be using code behind, but to be using a technique like MVVM or MVC if you want to, or something that separates your code away from the user interface a bit more. And that's really where you start talking in terms of more sophistication. So moving away from the simple demo, you might move towards something where you're going to use view models. I don't know, I'm talking to server guys maybe in the room. Are you MVVM friendly in the room? Are you? Yeah, a few nods, a few people saying when's lunch. It's fine. So if we take a look at a typical MVVM project that I'll put together, then what you will have, for this, we're going to do a Twitter sign-in as well. So you'll have a view model for sign-in and a view model for actually displaying once you've done the sign-in. So in this view model, I'll just talk about this one and not the other, given timing. What you'll see is that we get hold of a service using dependency injection. Yeah, this service is our Twitter server, as it were, our TweetPic server. And what we'll do is when we first start up, or whenever reload gets called, make that a little bit larger, we will call get latest photos, and we'll also call another one, which is get latest photos for token, and that's my photo. So you'll have two tabs on the screen. And then this will return to the UI using data binding the list that's all and the list that's mine. You'll see some funny iNotify property change things, which tell the UI that things have changed, so it should redraw. And then we'll also look at upload in a moment. Obviously, having written this, this is a, as it says at the top here, is actually a Win32. It's a console library at the moment. You can write tests for it. So this guy here is actually a MS test rather than NUnit. I tend to use NUnit because it's more cross-platform. But for this, I quickly put together some tests. So for example, if we take a look at main, then hopefully we'll see some real tests in here. Some of these are stubbed out, I should admit. So there's some test setup, which is, you know, setting up the IOC. Then there is a something that says creating main requests. Creating main requests everyone's photos and my photos. So basically, I've used mock here, which is MOQ, in order to do the testing. And that testing here, you know, it's not the most readable test script perhaps in the world, but you can see what it does is it checks that after I create my main view model, it verifies that get latest photos was called, and that get latest photos was for token was called, and then, you know, it checks that the actual mine and all are still null at this time because they're asynchronous calls, and this test hasn't done it. Yeah, and you just write a few of these tests. Obviously, this one I ran out of time, didn't write. And you can just run these tests. I think I ran them earlier. Let me run them just to prove they run. And you can see the debug there is. Run those tests. Hope that will go off. Run. Anyone see where that window went? Obviously, for TweetPic, it doesn't matter. Okay, so they've all passed. For TweetPic, it doesn't matter too much. For your business applications, the fact that these actually work and continue to work and work in a year's time when somebody changes the application, that's where these things really come into their own and have value. Yeah. So given that you've written that back end, how do you then actually use it? Well, in this particular example, I haven't used portable libraries, which is my preferred way of doing it. There's still some pain with portable libraries. They have improved a lot, but there's still pain. So what I've done is, for example, for Windows Phone 7, this is actually a cut and paste of the console. These files are actually the same location, so if I try to open a view model, it will whinge because it's opened in another project. So it's a cut and paste of the project structure, but it is exactly the same code inside, and this code is portable. You know, there's nothing in this view model, wherever it is, that is specific to Windows Phone 7. There's nothing that's specific to MonoTouch in there, there's nothing specific to MonoDroid. This is generic code that you can just rebuild. You can run it on the Xbox if you really want to. I think you can, I'll have to check that. So you just copy and paste those across, and then when it comes to binding to the UI, for example, then you'll just put a structure in place. Did I lose it? And your views, like a main view, won't have any particular exciting code in them. Okay, it's got a little bit of code here because I'm being a bit naughty about how I do my image showing. This code is very UI specific in here. This is just about how when I click on an image, I get a large one, which doesn't really have anything to do with application behavior, so I thought I could get away with it putting it in here. I think if that was a code review, I'd get shouted at. But you can instead, if you want, just look at the XAML, and the XAML hopefully will show you how simple the binding is. Now, do they view code? This is where Visual Studio crashes. Sorry. Go on. You can do it. So you will see here that there is a pivot control. It's all very declarative. It can be edited inside Blend if you happen to know how it works without your eyes bleeding. No, Blend is really powerful. Sorry, I shouldn't be too mean to Blend. Blend is really very powerful, and it's worth getting to know. I just don't get on with it. I didn't get on with Flash either when I tried. So what we'll see here is that you've got a list. The list is bound to all. And we also have another list here, which is bound to mine. I think a little bit of naughty code behind is the application bar I'm going to use for this guy. Windows Phone 7 application bar is actually part of the framework and not part of your application, so binding doesn't work by default to it. So again, I've hooked it in a bit naughty to that command. So hopefully we can run this guy up as well. I've never used a screen this big for it. So if we get rid of him and we go to our proper application, then we should be able to load him up. And at this point, we'll see the first view, which is sign-in view, assuming this is working. Okay, so sign-in view, this page is actually going to be presented by the server. again, kind of a nuance the way I do my Twitter authentication is if you ever do a Twitter app, you get two values from them. Number one is your application identity, and number two is something called secret key. Almost every single application then puts that secret key into the client app, at which point it's no longer secret. So if you do want to know what, for example, TweetDeck's secret key is, then just download their source, download their XE, and you'll find it very easy. So I believe I know a password for this. So if I go in as a new user, oh, that's quite handy. And then I believe this last password is this. Can anyone see it being printed on the screen? Right, you know it ends in 0RD. I don't know what it is. Then you can sign in, and again, you know, I haven't got time definitely to talk through this code at the moment, but you sign in, hopefully that's gone off to the server, it's doing a round trip on the server, it's then going to authenticate through the view model, yeah, which again is testable code. Hopefully it's come back, and then what it should do is it should pull back a list of, oh, go on, work. Yay! So it should pull back, and this looks like, again, it's not actually doing gzip, or maybe it's just the emulator's running. So it's pulled back a list of all, and it's pulled back a list of mine. At this stage, mine contains nothing, so you can, if you want to, connect to the photos. Sorry, this emulator's running very slow. It may be because I've got Windows Phone 8 emulator up, and an Android emulator, and a few other things. And then if you upload a photo, obviously everyone likes, you know, a screen. Then hopefully what we'll see is this actually goes back to the application, it uploads to the MVC service, that MVC service will talk to that service inside there, the dependency injection thing, it will upload the thumbnail and the real thing to blob, and then it will fail to show it on the screen. If I click it, do I get the large one? Oh, obviously I have failed in my demo gods today. So it did upload it. It obviously succeeded in uploading because it's gone through to the SQL database in order to come back to here. So there wasn't an exception thrown or anything. Why it's not shown on the screen, I have no idea at this stage. If only I had done a planky and really pre-recorded my demos. I was quite jealous of you doing that. I was thinking, why didn't I do that? So that's Windows Phone 7. Surprise, surprise, Windows Phone 7 is C#. That is not where you stop, however. I think the numbers are something like, just in terms of the Samsung Galaxy S3 on its own, 30 million of those now shipped. iPhone, it's 300 trillion gazillion. Yeah. The world out there has got, you know, a huge variety of devices, and the people you work with have got a huge variety of devices. The people you want to buy things from you or to look at your adverts, they've got a huge variety of devices. So typically you want to support these other things like Droid and Touch. This Christmas is going to be a tablet Christmas for every household with, you know, iPad Mini, Google Nexus, Microsoft Surface, etc. So you really need to support these other devices. I won't show you WinRT because other people are going to, and also because I'm running inside Visual Studio 2010 at the moment, so I can't really develop that. But I can show you what happens in terms of Droid and Touch. So just starting with Droid. What you'll find out is that we've got exactly the same code again in terms of the core. Yeah, so nothing has changed here. We've got, you know, another service link. We've got the same view models, exactly the same code. If I click on it, it'll tell me it's already opened another project. You've got the same test harness around it. It's the same reliable thing. You have some security. You know that when you ship, it should still work because your test harness is passed. And then around that, we put some UI. So in particular, if we just take a look at home view again, then what you'll discover for Droid is that we do have, let me just zoom this. It's a little bit complicated because it's a tab UI. What you'll see is we set up a tab for all, and we set up a tab for mine. There is some menu creation, which can't be done any other way. But what you'll see is if you click on the menu item and you hit upload, it'll go to upload execute. And then most of the UI is done in a XML format. Does anyone do Android development in the room, other than Dave? Yeah, okay, so if you know this XML format, you know, instead of having, okay, that's not very exciting, but instead of having a XAML, you've basically got these other things, so, you know, it's the same type of words. Instead of a stack panel, you have a linear layout. Yeah, one big gotcha for users is stack panels are vertical by default, linear layouts are horizontal by default. So when you start doing things and you wonder why on earth you can't see anything, it's because it's drawing off the right-hand side of the screen. That gets you pretty much every week. But you can see how these things put together. If you then look at how a list item is drawn, you will see that what there is we've put a binding-like format in there. So, you know, to draw the HTTP image, look at the thumbnail and just bind to it. If you want to click on things, again, there's an iCommand type thing. For touch, for MonoTouch, we do a similar thing. There is an XML format for MonoTouch and for Objective-C. However, for a simple UI, the XML file will be about 300, 400 lines long. And it's not human-friendly. It is a machine-readable format. It's got IDs that cross-reference all sorts of things. I think I can show a quick demo, actually, of the MonoDroid one. How many windows do I have open? Now, while I find this, quick competition, who has the most unread emails in their inbox for one of these? Anybody want to, I guess? I might end up with this one. Know what I'm looking for this? Okay, I'm at 65,000. Inbox zero does not happen in my life. Okay, I win another one. Right. So somewhere here, if I just show you how we develop in MonoTouch, and of course, being well prepared, I already have this open. So MonoTouch, in order to develop for iPhone, you have to own a Mac. Yeah, they are very cunning. Apple, they are not. Okay, I can't get full screen. You have to own a Mac, and you have to, therefore, you can't run Visual Studio on a Mac. So you will have to run MonoDevelop. MonoDevelop is a community version of Visual Studio. It has improved hugely in the last year. IntelliSense is actually in some ways better than Visual Studio inside MonoDevelop now. It's quite nice, some things they've done. But it hasn't got ReSharper. It hasn't got NuGet. So there are other things you lack. But in terms of an environment that you'll be familiar with, you'll get up and running quite quickly with this guy. You may see a demo of it later. So this is the app running. You can see that it's got upload functionality. It's using the same view models. I'll quickly show you the code, but I've talked too long. And you'll see, you know, for this case, it did upload the photo at the top during that demo. I did record one demo. So, I'm not going to talk too much more about this, but you can see that in the back of here, in main view, what you've got is you've got some cell binding text. So again, it's the same sort of data binding that you've seen in the XAML and in the XML. And then you'll see the little bit of code to put a list together with a horrible name. But you can see, you know, that is all the code for the view. Everything is in the back end and is testable. It's exactly the same code. A little bit of cheat there, actually. So hopefully what you've just seen, going back to the talk, is we saw the simple client. You saw how few lines of code you can write this thing in. So if you don't know how to develop MVVM, you don't know how to develop mobile, you can hack it. Yeah, this is something you can do in your bedroom. You can put on the store for £2, and 300 million people will download it, and you'll be rich. And I want 10% if they do. So you saw the simple code. You saw how few lines it is. And you saw that it used data binding. We then talked about, you know, going up from that kind of survival mode to more sophistication, how you could use view models. And then for sophistication, you can see how those view models can be reused across everything. All right, somebody yawned. You can prove it. Yes, have one of these. Yay, all you have to do is yawn in my speech and I'll bribe you into paying attention. So you can prove it, yeah? It's really important you can prove your code, particularly if this is a B2B thing, you know, run these tests, put them in place. Consider it that you would be taking over this code in a year time. What would you want in place? Yeah. I didn't show you the Droid version, but that's what it looks like. It's got a tab display, and you can upload some lovely looking houses. Some of them are happy. We showed briefly some of the UI code. It is declarative, so it's kind of more accessible to designers if they want to get hold of these things. I still haven't found a designer who'll work with me on XAML. Which is why I'm quite looking forward to using HTML and WinJS in the Win8 world. But you know, these guys do exist out there, and they can edit these things. For things like the Android world, there are thousands of examples of quite good-looking Android XML where you can put sophisticated UIs together. Also, some of the companies you're familiar with, so particularly people like Infragistics, they are now porting their code across to MonoTouch and to MonoDroid and to the iOS world, because obviously it's a developer opportunity for them. So some of the controls that you're used to using, some of the charts that you've used, and some of the grids that you've used are now available on these other platforms. So you can bind to them natively in those guys as well. It's still not as easy as using, it's not as easy as using a JavaScript and a jQuery, and it just works, as long as it does just work on all these platforms. But those guys are there, and if you want that native UI, you want that 2x interaction from your users, and you know you want that gazillion pounds coming into your bank account, then that is available. So hopefully, going through that demo, sorry, took longer than I expected, talk a lot. Hopefully you've seen on the server side, you wrote C#, you wrote your access, you wrote your business logic, you wrote your presentation, just that JSON wrapper. And then on the client side, we kind of have the business logic, which is the view models. We have some local data services, you probably didn't see it, but when you logged in, it actually stored that login to a file. You can use SQLite as a database on all the platforms. It's a really good database to use. There's service consumption, which talks to these guys, your business logic, and the UI logic, and the services, and the view models. And then that is shared across all those different things. So that's really where you start to reach sophistication. Typically, if you're starting in a business app, you might only be targeting one of these guys at the bottom. Yeah, but it's good to architect your code so you can target the others. Yeah. Particularly, you know, who knows what the device of the world is going to be next year. People like Amazon are obviously coming out with new devices all the time, Google and the Nexus range, Microsoft, and the Surface phone I can announce exclusively today. And be shot for. No, I have no inside information on that one. let me move on very quickly. Examples of apps that I've written. Okay, so the first app I ever wrote was Windows Mobile 6.5 and was a GPS running app. It's really important. This is native because it needs to run in the background, it needs to talk to GPS, it needs to do mapping, it needs to do all sorts of things which work better in native UIs. And so I ported that first to MonoTouch a couple of years ago. Then I ported it to C++ and put it on Samsung Barda. And then it ended up in its current home, which is on Windows Phone 7. It needs to move to Windows Phone 8. If anyone has any spare time, please give it to me. And the way that this works is actually, it's a hybrid application. It actually runs on a server in Germany. I get a server with 8 GB of RAM, a terabyte of data, and whatever else I need. It costs me about 30 quid a month, so that's why it's on a server in Germany. It also stores on that server, I think it's my favorite bit about the application because it stores 35 gigabytes of NASA data. Any application that uses NASA data is good for me. But all of the GPS traces I actually store in blob storage. This application, a few years ago, is written using Amazon's S3 storage. If I write it today, it would almost certainly be on Azure just because that's where all the rest of my stuff is. The advantage of that is that my blob storage is currently running at about 120 gigabytes. Of data, and that's compressed, that's gzipped. Yeah? And my SQL server is still running at about 6 GB. Yeah? If I put that data inside there, I would be begging Microsoft for licenses and I'd probably have to shut down. Yeah. And most of that data is never accessed because it's GPS data from years ago. Another example, so this is a genuine cross-platform thing and is actually open source, so you can use it. For SQL Bits this March, SQL Bits is a great conference if any of you are into SQL. There are a few developer sessions there as well. I wrote a conference app. Conference apps are one of the popular demos. And you can see how all of the view models are the same behind this. But you can see how the UI varies across the platforms on the screen. I also wrote one for Azure London conference app, who turned me down evilly. So we're going to move on from that one. But again, this was, so it's kind of the same app reused, but I added into it some QR code scanning. These are the types of things, again, which are harder to do in JavaScript because you have to talk to the camera, you have to process the QR on the client in order to read it into a hyperlink. And this is where you start to think, yeah, I wish I'd written this natively or used whatever. For QR code scanning, Google kind of have the default implementation called Zebra Crossing, and there's a port of that into .NET. And not only that, but Red, I don't know how you pronounce his name from GitHub, has now wrapped that in a control, so you literally just drop it onto your UI and it will give you the event saying, yes, I've seen a QR code, and put a red box around it and all that sort of thing. So it's wonderful to put these things together. And there are a lot of open source libraries coming through. There's now as well as SQLite, which is obviously open source, there's now a document database that you can run on the client if you want to. There are so many of these projects coming through. I think there's a video coming up soon. Hint. The project that I first did last year, which really got me into this cross-platform and MVVM stuff that I do quite a lot of my time on at the moment, was Connect Star Wars. They wanted a Twitter app, Twitter, Facebook, etc. Before that, I did a Fable app for advertising. So these are, you know, they're good business models for Xbox, because, you know, Xbox is still one of the few businesses where you can go out there and you can sell £50 box software on the shelf. Yeah, everything else has kind of come down to the £2 value in the App Store. But Xbox is still running, so it's worth putting these advertising models out. You can see the first one, we actually did the Fable 3. We had a back end which was mainly SQL Azure. We were running in Hibernate to it. And something called the Sharp framework on top of that, which kind of sits on top of MVC. But for client for that, we mainly used JavaScript, so that's a phone gap application on the left. It wasn't well received, being a phone gap application, and that's why second time around they insisted it had to be native. And so we wrote this application across all three platforms, or three major platforms, and it looked a little like this. So, you know, in terms of being a native experience on iPhone and Android, it was really important because, you know, I don't know how many people in here use a non-native Twitter app on their phone. No one. Yeah, I do actually use Twitter HTML page on my desktop, and I reckon in maybe 3 or 4 years' time, maybe I'll use it on my phone as well, a HTML one. But mainly, you know, we live inside a real native environment there, and if you try to do, you know, that scrolling effect or do anything that competes, going non-native, good luck to you. There are some actually lovely demos of doing in HTML, but can't be done. Azure app. So this is the 1.0 data thing I've ever done, and it was a very quick project. It was to do for Azure sales guys. I'm not sure they ever used it, but these budgets happen inside Microsoft. And oops, I better stop because they won't give me another one. But so here we put together an ASP.NET MVC website, which basically just hosted the use cases. There was also a CMS, so you could add more. And then there was an app that you could run through. And I still got this on my phone, actually, so I can still run it. No, I haven't still got it on my phone, if anyone's listening. You can see how we put that together. The OData interface made it really easy to get hold of all the data, to navigate it. You know, it was a very straightforward project to do. And because it wasn't consumer-facing, it didn't matter that it downloaded data quite verbosely and slowly for that situation. Mobile services, we're going to hear a little bit more about these this afternoon, so I won't talk about them too much. But what mobile services gives you the opportunity to do is to replace all that server-side logic with a black box, and to automate it. So if you are short of time, then you can do this very quickly, very straightforwardly. Nobody really knows where the pain points for this will come. For small applications, I suspect they will never come. For larger applications, at some point in the future, you may feel, oh my god, I'm stuck. I'm trapped in this ecosystem. However, mobile services uses REST, so at any point in the future you can write that REST server. You know, if you have the unfortunate problem of being wildly successful, you will find a way forwards. I suspect that also Microsoft would be very keen to publicize the fact you're wildly successful, so they will help you at that time if there is a problem. So you can see how that will replace the server side. An example we might see this afternoon. So this is my mobile service code from last night, it literally was a case of just dropping in a library. So Microsoft have actually contracted to Xamarin to port the libraries across and make sure they're portable. And in fact, most of the code is portable anyway, so it could have gone in a PCL. And we'll hopefully see that this afternoon. I'll boot up the Mac to show you it live. And that pretty much brings to an end and to lunch. I'm not sure how long it took. Hopefully we have seen C# running in the cloud. You know, it's not particularly sophisticated what I've shown you. I haven't shown you any worker roles. Those are available. As I say, the stuff I'm working on at the moment has huge background processing going on in Hadoop, and then we'll have client-side stuff on it, probably in JavaScript, but there's also a chance we might do a native app as well. You've seen C# in the clients. You know, it shouldn't be any surprise to you that WinRT and Windows Phone we use C# for. But also for MonoDroid and MonoTouch, it's accessible, and it's accessible to you guys. You know, you should. I didn't really show you launching MonoDroid from within Visual Studio, but you can do it. You know, MonoDroid plugs in that way. Hopefully MonoTouch will too soon, but at the moment it doesn't. But there is the Mono Develop platform for you to run. You've seen lots of C# code. Most of it didn't compile or had a catastrophic failure. You saw some real app examples. You don't get any time for Q&A. I don't know actually when's lunch ready. If you need any more inspiration, you know where to look for links. You'll be fine. That's just a selection. Azure.com, no surprise. Mobile services are there. Web API, highly recommend. Mono, if you want to get into the MonoTouch, MonoDroid world, you know, you can't afford to ignore the 30 million Samsung S3s. You can't afford to ignore the Amazon, the Kindles. Then I highly recommend you start with Xaminars. The Xaminars from Xamarin. There is a price involved with being a Mono developer. It's pretty much, I think it's about $400 to buy one license, but there are discounts at various times. That, if you are, you know, maintaining this code long term, will pay for itself very quickly. You know, if you do need a manager sign off, you can't always sell that to them. They'll go and learn Java. And then when you come back having done 3 weeks work and you still can't compile anything, they'll realize that they should have just spent the $400. Or they'll blame you, more likely. If you want to talk about Portable, I didn't really show the Portable demos. I might show them this afternoon. Portable libraries have improved a lot in the last year. Microsoft's new release of those with Visual Studio 2012 is good. Xamarin are a little behind on that in terms of tooling, but I build all my apps now Portable. Where you hit pain points, you have to, you know, work around them with dependency injection. But again, that just helps in terms of testability, so it's great. MVVM, that's my own repo at the bottom. And if it was a cinema screen, I could show you more pictures.
Very nice.
Okay, I believe lunch may be ready, or questions if we're not going to lunch.
Yeah, so are there any pressing questions? There seems to be a few. Let's take a few questions, maybe.
Yeah, I can take a few.
Okay.
Is that chili?
That is Argentina, and I think it looks like that one day a year. That's Cerro Fitzroy, and it's a great place. If you get to go there, it's really nice. Yeah. Yes, and I was there a few years ago. A few years ago, and our satellite Wi-Fi to our heart.
I saw you had a real quick, you had something on there about SigmaR. And I'm wondering if you're doing anything when you're pushing data server to client, or you're doing stuff where you need to have your app be notified from the server, that kind of thing. Kind of a related question. Sometimes when you're doing stuff like that, you have to make a state machine, and maybe you don't want to store the state in the database. Have you ever done anything where you need to have a more state machine sort of thing on the server side?
Okay, so there are several questions there. First of all, SignalR, and I'll link that also to that to Reactive, were announced as open source by Microsoft yesterday. So that's really good news that they have been open sourced. And pretty much within 2 minutes, Xamarin said, yes, we will make sure we maintain that open source portal as well. So those as technologies are going to be available. However, for mobile apps, if you are looking at doing, you know, chat applications or anything where there's a market trade that needs to come through, then the technology you really want to be looking at are push notifications. And you'll see some of that in the mobile services talk this afternoon. So what push notifications are things like toasts. Are you running Windows 8 yet? Or? Yeah, he is, okay. So things like the toast and the live tile things. So there was a good demo the other night at a Windows 8 user group. A Belgian TV station has launched their Windows 8 application. And they are sending every 5 minutes a new live tile to all 200,000 people that they expect to be downloading Windows 8. which shows the current screen of the TV every 5 minutes. Yeah. And they are going to send another push notification that is the you know, now and next. And they're going to do that every 5 minutes. Yeah. The store may complain at some point, so you should close your ears if you do work on it. But that type of information goes through a mechanism where basically you send it to an Azure service. And the Azure service then sends it, you know, via a back channel into your Surface or your iPad or whatever it is. Yeah. And then that gets displayed on the screen. So that push notification mechanisms are available. There are a few services to help with it, one of them being Azure Mobile Services, the other one being the one that's mainly, can't remember his name, ping me afterwards and I'll look up the main one that people use. It's something about Airship or something. It's a good service. The other question you asked was state machine. On the server.
Yes.
Okay.
You just got like the log app. You just use the Azure log app.
Yeah. So, if you, okay, so the server, the service definitions you tend to write are REST, and that basically means they are stateless things. So typically what you do if you want to have a server-side state is you use the same sort of trick you've been using in websites for years, where you know you have a database store of your shopping basket, which is state. And then you basically have an identifier token that you pass across. You don't normally store that state in RAM. Yeah, you normally store it in database. There is one technique that is available on Azure. Yeah, it's available on other services as well. It's called Memcached on other services, Memcached D. On Azure, it's called Azure Caching. It's not cheap, but it is very, very fast, and it's very easy to set up. And you can use that instead of a database. If you need fast access to stateful information across your services, literally, it's just a case of plugging into web.config, and all of your clients can just use it. It's, I can't remember how much it costs, it's not cheap.
But it's actually a new version now, runs on memory on the on the instances themselves. So
And it's just in GA now as well.
Yeah, it just made GA. It's called, and this is your distributed cache.
It was the cache preview.
There you go. So that is effectively the same as Memcached, and it even has protocol level compatibility with Memcached clients, so you can connect anything and use
And it's got high availability.
And it
also depends on the type of application. I mean, you will see quite a lot. Before SignalR came along, or in its early days, you saw quite a lot of demos of long polling HTTP calls, which is basically what SignalR does under the covers. But using async and await in C# 5, you can actually write your ASP.NET controllers so that they, the action result is an async method. And that async method will not take up stack space because it's async. Yeah, and that means that you can hold on to them for a minute, which is what SignalR does on the campus space. But SignalR's just kind of got another subscription layer on top now.
Okay, any more questions?
I'm just going to ask if we can get the source code for
you. TweetPic, I haven't tidied up and put on source control. There is a lot available on GitHub slog MvvmCross. So things like the conference sample are there, but yeah, I will post it at some point, and I'll probably post the Azure Mobile Services sample, and for a small fee, I'll post the houses that look like faces.
Okay, is that all? Shall we break for lunch? Sounds good to me. Thank you very much. Let's take a little bit of a minute now, so make sure you're back here by 1:45. Okay, thanks.
Yeah, that was absolutely excellent. Send me email in those spaces immediately.
Anyone know how to stop recording?